countries that have actually invested more recently into infrastructure. ASCE is the one who's produced this report card. ASCE does have a national branch, or international branch. A lot of countries may have produced something like this similar, but nothing that you could correlate to this particular one. But there are statistics that we look at that will help correlate those together. For instance, some countries in Europe, Norway, Finland, some of those actually have better systems than we do because they've invested more money. They have a different way of looking at it. And so that's what he talked about. If anybody heard in the video, you know, we're no longer trying to build the best projects anymore. So sometimes you end up paying for that. So that's one of those things. Yeah.
You know how much China's infrastructure has increased over the past few years?
I can't give you exact numbers, but I can tell you the amount of money they spend in relation to the United States. I mean, their growth rate is insane because that's how they've supported their economic growth. Civil engineering and the transport of goods, whether it be through rail or air or on the road, is extremely vital to an economy. So civil engineering basically is the backbone. So I talked about the Three Gorges Dam earlier to the other group. That's a dam that's gigantic. They flooded out 1 million people to build this dam to produce power for a large portion of their economy. So that's just a piece of what we're talking about. So their investment is in the hundreds of billions of dollars, and that's probably 5, 6, 7 times what we spend on infrastructure here annually. And you gotta remember too, they're actually building some of their very first infrastructure, like we did in the 50s with Eisenhower and some of those, our roadway system, actually built a robust system like that. So, did everybody get one of these? Make sure. So what I wanted to show you in this and what they kind of alluded to in there's a lot of different categories of civil engineering that you can get involved in. And inside this pamphlet, if you open it up, you'll see that there are 7 listed. And I'll go through those really quickly, but understand that these are just a small cross-section of the entire amount of disciplines that are involved with civil engineering. So one of the first things is when we put together construction projects, we design them in our office. And so what that means is that there's a set of paper documents that we all have. And that means nothing to the end product. It does, but it's very critical that those documents and sets of plans we put together get executed properly in the field. So that means when you guys saw construction going on outside of your high school here, probably this past year, you see guys out there working. Well, somebody has to make sure that money that they're getting to build this project, the project's done properly. It's followed by the plans, it's followed to the specs. Taxpayers' dollars go towards these projects. That's how these projects get done for the most part for the stuff that we do. Roadways, bridges, dams, a number of different things. So the money that your parents pay or you pay when you're buying something or making money, that goes towards this infrastructure. So it's very critical that money is being spent properly and that you're getting, the taxpayers getting what they pay for out of that. So that's where construction engineers come in, because they execute the contract. They make sure it's done in the field properly. And that's a pretty critical piece of making sure that project is done. There's a lot of different factors in this, and none of them are more important than the other. They all play a role into making the final product or making stuff that works for you guys. Also in that process is our environmental engineers. And they could do a cross-section of things. The way we get involved is several times over. We work with agencies, IDEM and IDNR, which are the Indiana Department of Environmental Management and Indiana Department of Natural Resources. So if you're doing a project, you have all this dust, you have all this stuff that can pollute the waterways, it can cause air pollution, there's noise pollution, there's also even stuff called light pollution. So these are practices and measures that these guys pay attention to that we have to incorporate in our projects to make sure we're not polluting things, make sure we're not tearing down trees and ruining habitats for animals, because we did that for so long that we started to have an adverse impact on our environment. And so this becomes a very critical piece. Other things environmental engineers do, like when you guys throw stuff away, it goes to the waste, goes to the landfill. Somebody has to design that to make sure that's not polluting our water, making sure if you ever drive on the bypass, you'll see that big pipe sticking up next to the bypass that's got a flame constantly coming out of it. That's methane gas that's collected from the landfill that's burnt off so that's not polluting the air pollution to the environment. In addition, they capture that and utilize that in a lot of their different energy, like their different buildings and stuff like that on site. So there's some really cool pieces to that, and that's all done through environmental engineering. So a couple good examples of that. Geotechnical engineering doesn't sound real flashy, but whenever you build something, you're building it on an existing soil probably. We need to know what's going on underneath that, especially if it's a dam or if you're building something below the ground. You have to know what's on it in order to know it's going to support it or it's going to work. I mean, there are whole groups and companies that's all they do is they analyze rock, they analyze soil. I have a really good outside of South Bend over by the Lowe's and all of that. There's all that work that was going on. You know, we were involved in some of that as well. So that's transportation. Yeah, go ahead.
Well, in terms of transportation, I heard that California has been investing in a high-speed rail between LA and San Francisco.
Sure.
And then I also heard that they were discussing another possibility of or mode of transportation that would have been like a vacuum sort of thing.
Vacuum train?
Vacuum train.
So go ahead. Sorry.
Could you just
That's part of transportation. And in fact, the United States, I think one of the initiatives that the current administration is trying to push is multimodal transportation centers. I mean, you can come in by train, you can come in by air, and mass ways of moving people because we have a problem of limited resources. California is probably more progressive in that, and so we would help. There's a whole lot of things that go involved with that. If you're going to build a new train line, you got to think about it. Like, where from here to, say, Chicago, do you have a place that's just an open path that nobody lives at? There are no streams or rivers. There isn't. It doesn't exist. So you have to buy people's property. You have to, you know, for fair value, you have to design, you have to permit, like we talked about with this environmental agencies. There's a lot of different factors. You have to work with multiple different governmental groups, you know, cities, towns, states, even in some cases. So there's some real challenges. But those are all good things, but yeah, absolutely. And then you're actually just designing the track itself. You know, having a vacuum train, that's pretty cool. I mean, that's stuff that's pretty high tech. You know, they talked about a transcontinental line that would go from Alaska to Russia. I mean, that's something that's really cool, and that's actually coming to fruition. Like, you know, some of those things actually happen. So that's transportation engineering. More on a local level, what you'll see is if you sit at a stoplight forever and you see 100 cars backed up, that's not been designed properly to handle the number of cars that are involved. In Nevada, for instance, coming in, there's a mountain pass. I'm not going to remember what the name of it is, but they have a total of 8 lanes. So in the morning when everybody's coming to work into Vegas, there are 6 of those are dedicated to coming in and 2 of them are dedicated to coming out. And then they switch them over because they're basically, it's called smart transportation engineering. They're utilizing the stuff that they have without spending extra money to make this monstrosity of a highway when all they need to do is use technology and planning to switch traffic back and forth to utilize the dollars that they've spent. So that's some of the stuff that they do. You know, traffic signal timing. You should be able to go, most places you should be able to go, and you've ever hit every light when you're going somewhere and how frustrating that is. That's poor transportation engineering. That would be signal timing. So those are some local levels. But yeah, also on a much larger level, that's part of transportation engineering too. That would get into a whole nother section outside of highway design. That would get into people who work with railroads because the way those are designed are slightly different than roads and some of the challenges that you meet there. So that's a good question. And then you have like urban planners and water resource engineers. Urban planners are people who plan your city. Where should the you don't want a big industrial plant with all these different things that you need to handle right next to a residential neighborhood. That's poor planning. That's also means it's an inefficient use of land that ends up leading to you have to mitigate certain things. Meaning, like, if you have a bunch of sound, then you build things to mitigate sound so people who live close to it don't hear that sound and pollution and things of that nature. So that's important. It's important in terms of use of money and then also long-term planning. And then water resources, that's stuff that we also do. We design dams and hydroelectric dams. That actually, I was talking about the Three Gorges Dam in China. That's one of the things that utilizes water resource engineering, along with drainage, studies of rivers, a lot of other ecological impact things that we also get involved with. So, does anybody have any questions about those or any specific interests? So this is a good resource if you guys want to use this. There's online stuff here that you can go and look at if you want. This infrastructurereportcard.org is really cool. There's a lot of different videos and things on there that you guys can look at and see. So since we've talked about kind of the different disciplines of engineering, I guess I'll probably talk a little bit more about my job and where I work. So what I do is I do anything from, I've done everything from transportation engineering, which is designing large interstate highways to I worked on a hydroelectric dam, which was really cool because you produce energy from those and there's a lot of different impacts. You know, you have huge lakes behind these, they call impoundments. So our job, we do a lot of local projects and we do everything from water resource engineering, transportation, all the things that we've talked about already in this besides geotechnical, we do. So it's a very large cross-section. And generally, it's important that we have some level of communication abilities. If you guys know any engineers, most of us are pretty boring sometimes, so and we don't like to talk to people. So that's something that is changing. In an international level, we talked. She asked a question about international. That's something that everybody looks to us to do. We have much more experience in a lot of these areas, and so it's important that we learn how to manage those and manage our skills and be able to talk to people. So I won't get too much into that at this point. So the job, there's another thing I want to pass out that has some local projects that might help bring. Thank you. So when Mrs. O'Grady is passing this out, you'll see in here, it'll give a little bit brief conversation again about what engineering is real general. We've kind of covered that already. But then in this, you'll see, and I'll wait till you guys get it. But thanks. All right, so in this you'll see like the Indiana Toll Road, and that's really important because Indiana is the cross-section or the crossroads of America. So we talk about moving goods and services and stuff. Indiana plays a key role in the United States to moving those goods and services. I think it was like Indiana's roads and rail transported $450 billion worth of goods two years ago. So that on average, that's how much they're moving in services over those different pieces of infrastructure. We're talking about tons of money. And civil engineering is the building block of all of that. That's what supports the ability for people to move those goods and to transport them in an efficient manner. Another one that we'll probably point to that is something that we did in our company that I'm pretty proud of is the East Raceway in South Bend. If everybody ever been downtown South Bend, you see that course that people take kayaks and stuff through. We actually designed that back in the mid to late 70s. Part of the thing that's cool about that, that's one of only two in the entire United States that's a man-made waterway like that for kayaking. So this is actually my boss, who's now retired, went to Germany, and this is modeled after one that's in Germany that was used for the Olympic trials, or used for the Olympics back in the 60s. So it's really cool. There's some really cool pieces of infrastructure. This is a really good example of water resources coming together with environmental and structural and some other site development things that go into just this one project. And it's just a really cool way of looking at things. And even if you can't appreciate or don't have appreciation for the civil engineering because you're not interested in that, you can certainly understand the impact these have to everybody around you. And then I mentioned the hydroelectric dams on the top right corner here. You'll see the Sturgis, Michigan hydroelectric dam. That's one of the dams that we monitor and do designs and fixes to. So that's just, again, that's another piece of engineering that we get involved with that you may be able to see. And then there are things like the courthouse that you see below that are, we perform a small amount, we're slightly involved in, but we're not, the focus is more the beauty of the building and maintaining that and maintaining the use. So we serve kind of as what we call a tertiary or secondary person to that, meaning we're coming in, we're just making sure that it's going to stand and that the integrity and the additional beautification they want to do this building is possible. And so we're just making sure that happens. So, you know, I understand that not everybody, doesn't like the engineering portion of it, but people can really get behind something that looks good, that they like, that are interested in, historians, things of that nature. We also do work to help back that up as well. I think one of the things I want to point you guys to is this on the back side, on this one fold, you'll see a number of websites you can go to and look at. They range from societies to get involved in, to educational pieces and associations. So there's all kinds of information to go out there if you guys are interested. It's just take your own initiative if that's something you really gear into. In addition, on this other fold on the back side, you'll see several engineering groups that are involved in our area. This is probably just a small cross-section of them, but there are a lot. These are all private consultants, so they all work towards towards projects. That kind of bring me into the other fold is private consulting is not the only thing that civil engineers do. There are tons of different things that civil engineers can get involved in. I will say, in terms of an engineer, the salary is really nice, but those vary widely between different portions of civil engineering. For instance, I'll give you guys some examples. You can be a professor in civil engineering. I have a really good friend who's a professor at Notre Dame. He teaches students on top of doing research. So if you're a professor, he's really interested in cutting edge technology, things that are impacting us. He did stuff on flood inundation. So Hurricane Sandy, any of the flooding in New Orleans, all of that, he predicts and models how that's going to flood places so that we can understand that ahead of time and build defense systems that will help mitigate that or reduce that flooding, you know, saving lives, reducing costs, a number of different things that are involved. So that's, if you're a professor, you're not just teaching people, which is extremely important. You're also doing research to help a better society, make it better for people to live and understand and be safe. So that's one. State DOT or Department of Transportation, we often work with these individuals. They're more in charge of managing and maintaining and knowing when things need to get fixed and putting together plans and then communicating to us to help them and also our state legislators and our national legislators. And I think that's one portion, again, that you can get involved in legislatively. You can go downstate, you can lobby. A lot of our money comes from taxpayers. You guys support infrastructure. So in order to make sure that money's getting spent correctly, because we all know politicians like to spend money in places that may get them elected as opposed to providing systems or pieces and parts for people who that actually matter, where it makes the most impact. So that's where we would get involved somewhat, is we would go down to state and we would review these bills. We would talk to our legislators, state senators, and explain to them what the critical pieces of infrastructure and bills are that they should be focusing on and how we want them to do that. And sometimes we're heard and sometimes we're not. But we still have to put that effort forward to make sure we're representing the general public in the best way that we can. And so in addition to that, I also go nationally. I've had the opportunity to go down into Washington, D.C. and meet with people like Joe Donnelly and Jackie Walorski and go talk to them, go sit in. I went during the whole crisis, so in 2009 when everything was falling apart, I was actually down on the floor in the House and saw everybody coming off, Timothy Geithner and all these guys that were talking about all these bills. It's really cool. That's a really cool portion of it. I know that's not, reading bills isn't very interesting, but impacting how people's money is spent and impacting how to better people, that's one of the really, one of the things I get the most out of civil engineering is helping people, because what I do impacts every single person in here. And I think that's really cool. That's something that I enjoy out of it. You can also work as county and city engineers and relate to the general public. So you can do things with like the city of Mishawaka or the city of South Bend, have people that pay attention and manage, again, like kind of like the state DOTs, they manage their infrastructure, they call consultants in to get involved. So I talked a little bit about some of these websites. There's a lot of organizations that are related to civil engineering. ASCE is one of them. That pamphlet that I handed out has ASCE at the bottom of it. That's American Society of Civil Engineers. They've been around for 150 years. So the information that they have and the amount of experience that they have, it goes towards educating people, general public and engineers. It goes towards backing projects, backing good bills, making sure that people get and support the infrastructure that they really need. One of the cool things in college, when I was in college, that we did with ASCE is we built a concrete canoe. in his concrete canoe contest. And so you actually go and you build these concrete canoes and you get in them and you race them. And we're talking in March, so in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, so it's cold. You don't want your canoe to sink, trust me. There were people who, in fact, did that. But you know, you'd rate, there will be teams from Wisconsin and Purdue and Rose Holman and a number of really good institutes, and we build concrete canoes. And usually I say, okay, yeah, right, a concrete canoe, that's going to definitely sink. But the weight of water per unit is 62.4 pounds per cubic foot. You have to build a concrete canoe that's unit's weight is less than that. And so you do things with the concrete to change that. And the reason I point that out is because, you know, these things aren't just about, well, we're going to sit behind a computer and, you know, admittedly a little dorky, but you know what I mean? We're not just going to do that. We're going to get out and get involved and do things that are hands-on, and that's awesome. It's really, you meet people that enjoy the same kind of things, and you make good friends, and these societies help build you as a person, so when you go along and do other jobs, it's really critical that you learn these skill sets. And so they kind of help you that. And there are a number of things like Indiana Association of Cities and Towns. You work with mayors and things like that. It's important for you to have a large cross-section of these to get involved with, so you know how to approach people and you can find your niche, find what you really like. So I encourage you, go ahead and look at those websites. If you don't like it, it's fine. At least you looked at it and you've given an opportunity and kind of look into what you wanted to do. So I guess I'll talk a little more about my job, kind of bring it closer to home. I don't know if you guys are familiar with Mishawaka and Central Park in Mishawaka over by the dam. I was fortunate to work with a private, public-private development. And so essentially it's the hospice project. So hospice came in, they wanted to build a new campus in Mishawaka. And I don't know if you guys know what hospice is, but hospice is for those who are terminally ill. So one of the things that was really important to them, not only did we need to increase the infrastructure to make it better to handle all the people and the utilities, water, sanitary, electric, all of these things, we also had to make it look nice because they wanted people to be able to enjoy what they saw around them in the time that they were spending there. And it was quality of life is extremely important to this company because of the people that they serve. So it was a really unique project because we got to put some of those really cool features, statues, things that are visually appealing to people. But, you know, essentially, probably, as you can tell, this is not easy to handle sometimes.
Good paper.
So one of the things I was, and this is something that you'd see in a set of plans that would go out to a contractor that's going to build it in the field. He's going to look at these things and he's going to have to know what's in there. There are 57 sheets of information that we put together for this project that he has to read off of. And that's a small portion. We have a contract document that is well in excess of 300 pages. It's like 2.5 inches thick that we assembled that this guy has to follow. And that goes with everything from permits that you obtain from people. And don't think you do this all yourself. Like literally a team of over a dozen people worked on this project. So, and this is multiple different firms, different groups that are involved. So again, your communication skills are really important in that aspect. But you know, you've got your roads here that you're building in, you got parking lots. It's stuff that most of the stuff when you see it when it's done, you're like, well, that was nothing. Like it didn't take a whole lot. But underneath you have ways to drain the water. You have the gas. You have drinking water that has to be brought to the site. You have sanitary sewers. Also involved right here is a fish ladder at the dam. Well, the fish ladder is owned by an agency called the Indiana Department of Natural Resources. Well, a fish ladder allows fish to go from downstream to upstream to spawn. And in order to get over that dam, these fish can't jump 20 feet in the air. They have to follow this fish ladder, and that allows them to get up. So I only bring that up, it is kind of a cool mechanism that they utilize to do that. But I bring that up because that's just another piece of coordination that we had to do with people. And on top of this fish ladder, we actually put a statue to beautify it and make it look nicer. So that was probably one of the critical things. Of course, as engineers, we're not very artistic sometimes. So we didn't design that statue. We asked somebody else to do it. But again, that's just there are another pieces and parts, so many of them that go into our jobs that we do. The other thing that I wanted to bring up about this, you know, long-range planning, the Riverwalk, Mishawaka Riverwalk runs along here. We also helped design that. So that was in conjunction with this project. And there's also going to be a huge water park that's going to be built out here with like splash pads and pavilions and stuff like that. So that's just another, what would be called urban planning, the city of Mishawaka is engaged in to make the community better and the quality of life better around the area. So civil engineering is very much a quality of life issue too, that we can impact. Thank you. So I think I wanted you guys to see that so that you guys could draw some correlation to some type of project that was in your area. But if you really start looking around it, like my girlfriend hates it when we go places, because I'll look at something and be like, well, that doesn't look right, because you start paying attention to things that you wouldn't normally pay attention to because you've designed them or you looked at them in a different manner rather than just, I want to drive on this road to get there. How is it functioning? Are there traffic backups? You know, the things that we mentioned earlier. So those are really critical pieces. How much time do I have?
40 minutes.
40?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
10 to 15,
okay. Yeah, I can't do 40. Ooh, that would be, we can watch more videos. No, I'm joking. But one of the other things too, guys, that I wanted to do is bring it back to center and relate it to you guys in terms of college and high school. You know, there's some things that you can do if you're interested in it to just check it out. And it doesn't hurt to go do something, and if you don't like it, so be it. You never know what's going to come out of that. In addition to that, one thing I guess I failed to mention is civil engineering is one of those things that we always need. So you talk about people losing their jobs during a recession or can't find work. You've gone to school and you've gotten a degree and you can't work in that area because you can't find a job. Civil engineering is not one of those. It is always needed. You will always have to design. Everybody has to drink, has to use the restroom. It's one of the building blocks, the foundations of our society, a good society. If you didn't have hygiene, most large societies like Roman culture would have failed because of disease and things of those. These are absolutely critical pieces. So job security is huge. It's great. I mean, it's one of those things that is really important. I guess I'll start with high school. In high school, obviously I took a lot of math and science because that was what I was interested in. Try practical hands-on things too, you know. Get involved in stuff like if they have a drafting class that they offer. If you know, what does it hurt to try a class, try something? If you don't like it, then you realize that that's not an area you're interested in. But those are some things that I think that I did that were really good. Advanced courses. If you guys have the ability or have the aptitude to take advanced classes and knock off some of the what I'll call the weed out classes that they do in college. Everybody knows the first year or two of college is spent taking classes that are basics that you have to do requirements for, but they use those classes to see who's going to make it and who's not going to make it. And if you can take advanced classes and get rid of one or two of those classes in college, that's huge. I did it and I had to take 3 levels of calculus in college, differential equations. We're talking like math class after math class, chemistry 1 and 2, physics 1 and 2, yeah.
What is the difference between statics and calculus? Because I know you
got
to take statics.
No, statics. Statics is like the movement of, statics is the movement of bodies in motion. So it's basically like, there's things called vectors of motion. So if something's moving, it's moving in 3 dimensions. And so that's the study of things moving in 3 dimensions. We often complain about that. Statics and dynamics is what we had to take. We complain about it as civil engineers because how much of our stuff is really supposed to move? If my road is moving, then I've done a really bad job. So, but we do have those pieces that we get involved with. So I think, you're learning, civil engineering encompasses so much. You work with so many different types of people. You have to have a basic understanding of a lot of things because that allows you to be a more rounded person. And if you're going to design something, you better be able to understand how somebody else is thinking so you don't design something that flat out can't work because you haven't thought about the other pieces and parts that fit into it. Take advanced classes if you can. It really does help. Visit cool places. You know, the Hoover Dam. Go to places, the East Raceway. Like, take these places in. If you like them just for the fact that they're cool or you find them interesting, that's awesome. But if you're intrigued by them, maybe you should be a civil engineer. Maybe you should look more into that. You know, one of the things we were really fortunate with, I went to Elkhart Central. Don't hate me. I know. But one of the things that we did at Elkhart Central, they allowed us to do is, if we had all our requirements fulfilled by our senior year, we could take do an internship for half a day. So if you have that opportunity, so Penn offers something similar to that. Do
that.
Oh, wow. Okay. All right. So there is something like that. Get involved in that. That's a really good way to figure out what you want to do. I thought I wanted to be an architect and do buildings. So I did that internship my senior year, and I found out that's not what I wanted to do. I like something on a much larger scale. I wanted to do something big that, you know, that was really going to impact a lot more people. So the only way I found that out is by, and didn't waste my money or whoever money you're going to get to go to college, scholarship, waste a year of that time and realize, oh crap, this is not what I want to do. So it was very valuable in that sense. So check it out. You know, it doesn't, again, it doesn't hurt. It's at least some kind of a set of experiences. And then I said this last time too, you know, teachers may bristle at this a little bit because they spend a lot of time putting together information and plans for you guys. But one of the biggest things you can get out of school is learn how to learn. Like, learn how to be organized, learn how to study, because you're going to be learning for the remainder of your life. And that's not, you shouldn't be scared of that. That's a good thing. I used to think the same. I'd be like, oh my God, I don't want to learn anymore. I want to get out of here. Like, and that's true. But what you'll find is as you get older, instead of all these big cross-section of things that you're learning, you'll hone in on stuff that's really interesting to you. And so you'll want to learn how to learn, because you don't want to be that person that's left sitting out at a job because they never learned how to do that, how to take that information in, how to process it, how to learn what it is that they want to do, and then take that and retain it and use it towards something, whether it be, whether or not you're driven by money or helping other people, whatever it is, you know, those skill sets are really important. I didn't say this last time, time management is also a really good one too, because in college you'll be stressed, especially if you end up playing sports in college. Your time management will be critical, and then when you get into the job, you know, like I said, I managed over a dozen people on this project, and this was not the only project I had going on at the time. So these things take time, and they take a lot of time management and personal management. Learn how to do that. And don't overstress yourself. It just means pay attention to those things. Make a plan. Stick to it as well as you can. Those are things that you'll learn in high school. If any of you play sports, which like I did, that's one good way of learning how to do that. That's because you're working with a large group of people. Often you have to put together a team aspect. And working in teams, again, is really, really critical. So even if you don't do sports, get involved in some of these other programs. Get involved, doesn't have to be civil engineering, but get involved in something that requires you to be around people, requires you to interact. And even if you hate people, because some people do, like a lot of engineers will sit in their offices because they don't like other people, they don't like to interact with other people, but they still have to. And they're not going to be good at their jobs unless they figure out how to do that. I mean, you have to love it, just figure out how to do it. And high school is probably one of the better times with very little repercussion to do that. Because if you fail that at your job, you don't have income and you don't have a way to live. So it's better now to be able to do that and learn how to do that now. And then one other thing I guess I'll touch on before I start talking about college-related stuff. Fail to succeed. So don't be afraid to fail. I fail on a regular basis. It's not how you fail, it's how you succeed and how you respond to that failure. One of the reasons that we get hired by our company, by people that we represent, we have a 95% retention rate, meaning 95% of our projects that come in are from people we've already done work for in the past. And part of that reason is everybody makes mistakes. You're never going to not make a mistake. It doesn't matter. So once you make a mistake, it's owning up to it, fixing it, and responding to it properly. And that's why people retain us, because we own up to it and we make our mistakes right. And the reason I bring that up is because don't be afraid to fail. Put yourself in positions to fail, because you're never going to learn if you don't fail. It's okay. It took me a long time to learn that, but I think if you guys can do that, you'll be a lot farther along than what you think. So I kind of wanted to talk about college a little bit. We already touched about advanced classes. Make sure you can get as many of those in as you want or as you can. But, you know, get involved in these societies in college and stuff like that. They provide a wealth of opportunity. You know, like I said, the concrete canoe contest. I was 21 at the time, so I could enjoy the things that a 21-year-old can enjoy in Milwaukee, Wisconsin at Marquette University. We also made a lot of good contact because you got involved in the society. So get involved in those. You'll find that college will be really math-centric. for civil engineering. So you'll have a lot of those math classes like I talked about. But outside of that, in your junior and senior, you'll really take some classes that are really cool. A lot of labs. So for instance, one lab was a concrete design lab. So we'd pour these concrete cylinders, essentially, and then we'd get to crush them to see how strong they were, see how well our design mix worked, and if we met certain specifications or needs. This machine is like, I don't know, it's three times the size of that and as tall that you use to crush these things. And it's really cool. Like there's a lot of lab work to it, but it's hands-on. It's really engaging. So that can be difficult, could also be really fulfilling when you do that. Some of the requirements for civil engineering, in the next 5 to 10 years, you'll see some of those requirements change. It's going from a 4-year degree to a 5-year degree. So basically requiring some level of master's, 1-year master's to get to that point. Part of that reason is that almost every other country has some level. If you higher educated countries have another level of school that somebody needs to attend to be a civil engineer. And the United States is catching up. We're the forefront of information, but we're lagging behind somewhat in our education. So that's one of those requirements that's changing. So, and one way that I achieved getting through 4 years, and it wasn't a 5-year requirement, was to take a couple summer school classes. And don't be afraid to do that if you really want. I mean, if you want to stay at college for 5, 6, or 7 years and not be a doctor, you can do that. I can guarantee you'll exhaust your money or your parents' money or some other scholarship in doing that. It's much easier to get it done quicker. And so don't be afraid to put that extra effort in to do summer classes. Yeah. And one of the things I think that's important to note is, I said the job security is really good. The salaries are really good for private consultings. You know, starting out, you could make 45 or 50 grand coming right out of college. And that's really, really good. And just increase, that's the private consulting side. You know, contractors who do work, they have a lot more risk. They can lose money, but they can make well in excess of that as well. So I know money shouldn't drive everything, but that's one of the things that pay attention to. If you go to college, it shouldn't all be about what you want to make, but you should have some plan to pay that back. You know, I know I've got a lot of friends who went to college and they couldn't get a job, so they have these, you know, degrees that were really cool and stuff they were interested in, which is good, but they can't pay them back, and they're stuck. So make sure you pay attention to that. Civil engineering is one of those things that you can do that won't be the case. And there's, even if you go to college, I think it was like 70% of people who go to college and get a degree don't even use their degree in what they do now, and that's pretty common. It really is. So go to college to finish that degree. Set a goal, do it. And fortunately, with civil engineering, there are 1,000 different ways you can go. That's part of the beauty that I think it was involved with my choice of civil engineering. I knew I could do any number of things after I got out, and so that's important. A lot of flexibility. One of the other things that I'll mention is the testing requirements for certification after you graduate. So my senior year and most people's senior year, they'll take what they'll call the fundamentals of engineering exam. That basically allows you to enter into the civil engineering community with some way to earn credit for your time to gain success and status within your profession. So essentially it's an 8-hour test that you take at the end of college. And so it's two parts, one in the morning, one in the afternoon, four hour session. It's really grueling, but it's not that bad. It took me an hour in the morning and the hour in the afternoon, and I'm not super smart by any stretch of the imagination. So, but they're critical because after that, you have 4 years then to get a level, a set of experiences that allows you then to sit for your professional engineering degree. Or examination, and that really is the big one because you can get upwards of 15% increase in your salary as a result of this. Not to mention, going forward, you can head up projects, you can stamp your own projects, you could start your own company if you wanted to. I mean, there are a lot of different opportunities at that point. So those are really important pieces that you guys should be aware of. I wouldn't say, hey guys, go do this, and then you're like, well, that guy didn't tell me about that 8-hour test you had to take. That kind of sucks. But those are important things to pay attention to, because you want to know, plan out what you have, what you're required to do. Another thing that I'll mention, once you get out of college, continuing education hours. The state of Indiana has passed the fact that you need to have 30 continuing education hours every 2 years as an engineer to maintain your license. So again, it goes back to that lifelong learning thing. You're always going to be learning. And if you do any kind of significant professional degree, whether it be accounting or civil engineering or teaching or anything, you're going to have educational requirements. And we were just talking about one of the teachers had to get her master's. That's one of the requirements that you have to do as a teacher. So I won't talk too much about that, other than there are continuing education requirements. So basically, that's all. I mean, that's what I've got. I could expand on this for hours and talk about stuff that you guys don't care about, or you guys, have you guys ask some questions that maybe you guys have.